Okay, so we are discussing the problem of best approximation. I gave an example last time and stated a theorem. Let's look at a proof of the theorem. Let me write down the theorem once again, okay, so that we will keep it on this side for reference. We have an enough product space and a finite dimensional subspace. Okay, so let's take V be an inner product space and X is a fixed element. Let W be a subspace, not an arbitrary subset, be a subspace of V. Then we have the following. I think I also need to assume that U belongs to W, right? Let W be a subspace of V. And U be an element in W. Is that fine? Okay, we are interested in knowing when this U is a best approximation to X from W. When is U a best approximation to X from the subspace W? Okay. The first assertion is that U is a best approximation. To X from W, there is a necessary insufficient condition if and only if X minus U is orthogonal to the subspace W. Second condition, if a best approximation exists, then it must be unique, okay, so then it is unique. Third condition, if W is finite dimensional, if W is finite dimensional and let us say I have an ordered orthonormal basis U1, U2, etcetera, UN. This is an orthonormal basis. Then the unique best approximation. U is given by this formula. Okay, X is fixed, this U is related to X by means of these coefficients. So if this U1, U2, etcetera, UN is an orthonormal basis of W, then this is the formula for the unique best approximation to X from W. We have already seen an example where this formula was used. Find the point on the plane which is closest to a vector 1, 2, 1. Okay, proof. We need to show that this is a necessary sufficient condition, okay. A formula that could be used. Okay, let's prove this part first. Suppose that X minus U is perpendicular to W. we must show that U is a best approximation. Okay. Remember that the best approximation in the definition, this U must come from W. Okay. So if you take any W in W, it must follow that U minus W belongs to W. W is a subspace. And so this condition can be rewritten as x minus u, u minus w. This must be 0 for every w in w. Remember, u is fixed. Just as how x is fixed, u I know is a vector that satisfies this equation. U is a fixed vector in w that satisfies this equation. It is only small w that is a variable here. So this is true for all w in w. I need to show that U is a best approximation. I have this, I will use Pythagoras theorem. Consider x minus w the whole square. This is you subtract and add u, x minus u plus u minus w the whole square, subtract and add. Now observe x minus u and u minus w are orthogonal because the previous equation, and so by Pythagoras theorem, norm x plus y square is norm x square plus norm y square if x perpendicular to y. So this is norm x minus u square plus norm u minus w square, but this is always greater than or equal to norm x minus u square because this is non-negative. Norm u minus w square is non-negative, so this inequality holds, and I can take the square root because this is non-negative, this is non-negative. So it follows that norm x minus u is less than or equal to norm x minus w. This is true for all w and w, and this is precisely what we mean by saying that u is a best approximation. Okay. Converse, suppose u is a best approximation, we must show that this is 0. Okay. So conversely, okay, conversely, suppose that U is a best approximation. To x from W, we must show that U satisfies a condition that x minus U is perpendicular to W. Okay, for any w in w and lambda in R. See, V is an inner product space, so it might be a complex inner product space. I am restricting my attention to scalars that are real. For any w in w and lambda in R, what follows is that, remember that we have assumed that U is a best approximation. So if you look at norm of x minus u, that must be less than or equal to norm of x minus any vector that belongs to W, in particular u minus lambda W. This is true for all lambda, sorry, for all W in W and for all lambda in R. Okay, then I square, I will expand this using the inner product, see what I get. This is equal to inner product, I can rewrite this as norm of x minus u plus lambda w the whole square, and then do the usual expansion. Norm of x minus u square is one of the terms, plus this will go with lambda, this will be lambda lambda bar, but lambda is real, so lambda square norm w square. Then there will be two terms which can be written as 2 times plus 2 times lambda is a scalar, look at real part of x minus u with w. This is what one would get after expanding the right hand side. Lambda is real, so this is taken out. So if you compare with the left hand side, this x minus u the whole square can be cancelled, so what I get is lambda square norm w square plus 2 lambda real part of x minus u w. This is greater than or equal to 0. Now, this is 0 for all lambda element of R and for all w and w. In particular, for lambda positive, this is true. So, I will divide by take lambda positive divide by lambda to get lambda times norm w square plus 2 times real part of x minus u w. This is greater than or equal to 0 for all lambda positive this time and for all w in w. Now, what did I divide by lambda and why did I make the assumption lambda positive? In order to retain the inequality. Okay. Now, take limit as lambda goes to 0. For instance, take lambda to be 1 by n, the sequence 1 by n. Then, when you take the limit, this is gone. What it means is that, sorry, I left out a lambda. Yeah, fine. So, what it means is real part x minus u w is greater than or equal to 0. So, taking limit lambda goes to 0, we get real part of x minus u w. This is greater than or equal to 0 for all, see lambda was a variable, I have taken that as a sequence converging to 0. W is only variable now for all w in w. Real part of x minus u w must be greater than or equal to 0. W is a subspace. So, I can replace small w by minus w to get real part of x minus u w to be less than or equal to 0. Combine, you get real part of x minus u w to be 0 for all w and w. Okay. That is, I have applied, I have replaced w by minus w into this, and that is a valid operation because capital W is a subspace. So, I get this equation. Let us consider two cases. It is a real inner product space. If V is a real inner product space, then we have proved what we wanted. X minus u is perpendicular to the subspace W. If u is a best approximation, then x minus u is perpendicular to the subspace W. If V is a complex inner product space, V is a complex space, this real part of this is 0. So, let us say if let V be a complex space and let us take x minus u comma w to be alpha plus I beta. Then what we have proved just now is that then alpha is 0, real part of x minus u w 0 we have proved. Now, this equation is true for all w. So, I will replace w by I w. It is a complex space. So, the scalar can be taken from the complex numbers. Replace w by I w. Since this is true for all w, you replace w by I w, then it will mean minus beta is 0. Replacing I by I w, it comes in the second argument. So, when it goes out, it goes with an I bar. I bar into I is a minus 1 or a plus 1. I bar is minus I. So, that is plus 1. So, replacing I by I w, we get beta 0. Real part of x minus u I w is 0, but real part of x minus u I w is just beta. So, in any case, this is 0. So, once again, so just check these steps. Okay. If necessary, replace w by I w to conclude that x the imaginary part is also 0. So, that is the first part. Necessary sufficient condition for u to be best approximation is that this condition holds. Okay.
Sir,
Yeah. Replace W by W. Replace W by W. Okay. Second part is uniqueness. Uniqueness. Typically, to prove uniqueness, you will assume that there are two best approximations and show that they are the same. Okay. So let U and V be best approximations to x from W, then from the first part, x minus u, u minus v. See, u and v are best approximations. So by definition, they both come from W. So their difference is in W. So this must be 0. X minus u, u minus v is 0. Similarly, x minus v, u minus v is 0 by the first part. U and v belong to W. We have made use of that. I want to show u is equal to v. Consider norm u minus v square, show that it is 0. Norm u minus v square, we want to show that this is 0, then follows u is equal to v. You write it using the inner product, u minus v, u minus v. This time keep the second term as it is, modify the first one. U minus x plus x minus v, u minus v. Then that's u minus x, u minus v, plus x minus v, u minus v. Both are 0. Okay. So u is equal to v. If a best approximation exists, then it must be unique. The last part gives you a formula in case W is finite dimensional. So to prove the last part, that this is the best approximation to x from W, all you need to do is to show that x minus u is perpendicular to W. Then from the first part, it follows that this is the unique best approximation. Okay. So just show x minus u is perpendicular to W. That's what we'll do. But that has been done before. So the proof is over. You remember that in the very first theorem on best approximation, this has been done. This part was shown. Okay, so let me just write for the third part, refer to a previous result, where we have shown that x minus u is perpendicular to W. Okay. Okay. This is for best approximation from a subspace. There is a related question which will seek best approximate solutions for linear equations. Best approximate solutions, for linear systems of the form Tx equal to b. So let me post the problem first. Best approximate solutions for linear systems. This is a more important problem than the best approximation, but using what we have developed just now, this problem can be handled. So what is the problem? T is a linear map between inner product spaces. V and W are inner product spaces. I have a fixed vector B from the codomain. My question is, how to solve Tx equal to b? More an existential question. Does this equation have a solution? This has a solution if and only if b belongs to range of t. Okay. This system is consistent. That is, it has a solution if and only if B belongs to range of T. But often B may not belong to range of T. Typically in statistical applications, in experiments that one does in laboratory, for example, these equations will not be consistent, but one still wants to solve these equations. It is not consistent, but can we at least minimize norm Tx minus B? That is the question, okay. I will give you examples in the real inner product space, finite dimensional. So I will confine my attention to the case when V and W are real Euclidean spaces. So let us consider the case when V is Rn and W is Rm, in which case this will reduce to a matrix equation. This equation will be replaced by the matrix equation Ax equal to B. I want to solve the equation Ax equal to B. You can think of A as being the matrix of T relative to some basis. Think of A as being the matrix of T relative to some given basis for Rn and Rm. Then you know that this is consistent if and only if this is consistent. Range space of T is a range space of A. So I can think of A as a matrix as well as a linear transformation, okay. This is a usual practice in linear algebra. The question is, does this system have a solution? I mentioned that there are many situations where this does not have a solution, in which case we would like to minimize the norm of Ax minus B. So we are looking at the following problem. Does there exist? The problem is norm Ax minus B. I want an x in Rn such that norm Ax minus B is less than or equal to norm, let us say, Az minus B. X must be fixed. So this is fixed. This is like U. This is like U. This is like X. So let us try to reduce this problem to the problem of best approximation. B plays the role of X in the previous instance. Ax plays the role of U. I want to find an X such that norm Ax minus B is less than or equal to norm Az minus B for all z in Rn. See, A is a linear transformation from V into W. So A is an m cross n matrix. The domain of A is Rn, codomain is Rm. So A is an m cross n matrix. So this z must be from Rn. Z is a variable, X is fixed, B is fixed. B is like X, Ax is like U, this is like W. Norm U minus X less than or equal to norm U minus W. Sorry, norm U minus X less than or equal to norm X minus W. Okay, instead of X I have B, instead of W I have Az. Small w comes from capital W, that is a subspace. Instead of capital W I have range of A. Is that clear? So let me write then. This is like U, this is like X, this is like a general W from capital W. And so I will write capital W as range of A. This B of course is X. B is a fixed vector. I want to minimize norm. B is a fixed vector like X. I want to minimize norm U minus X. So among all vectors in the range of A, I pick that particular vector U which is equal to Ax. So the question boils down to finding X. I need to find an X in Rn that satisfies this inequality, these inequality. The previous theorem says that this problem has a solution if and only if certain condition is satisfied. That is, X minus U must be orthogonal to W. Then there exists X in Rn that satisfies, okay, let me give a name to this, called a best approximate solution. It is called a best approximate solution, best approximation from the previous discussion. This time X is called a best approximate solution it minimizes norm AX minus B if and only if X minus U perpendicular to W in the previous instance. Instead of X I have B, instead of U I have AX, that is in the range of A, and W belongs to capital W, capital W I have written, that is the range of A. So this B minus AX must be perpendicular to, let me write AZ, this must be 0 for all Z in Rn. This is the condition coming from the previous theorem. X is a best approximate solution, that is among all vectors, AZ, replace Z by X, then norm AX minus B is the least among all the numbers, norm AZ minus B. Look at this condition once again. I am in the situation when the space is Rn, so this is the usual inner product, and so I can write this in terms of the formula. What is the inner product between two vectors, let us say W comma Z, okay, let us say R comma S. R comma S is summation Ri Si if R and S are in Rn. I can write this as R transpose S, where I always write, when I write a vector standing alone, it will be a column vector, it will be a row vector. Any vector when I write in this situation will be a row vector. So R is a row vector, R transpose is that correct? I go back. Any vector standing alone will be a column vector. Any vector standing alone will be a column vector. So this R and S are column vectors, R transpose is a row vector, row into column, that is precisely this, okay. So this inner product can be replaced by this formula, I will use that here. 0 equals B minus AX, by the way R transpose S is also equal to S transpose R in the real case, okay. This is what I want really, S transpose R, transpose of this times this, AZ transpose times B minus AX, is this clear? I am replacing the, see this is a usual inner product, I am replacing the usual inner product by the formula involving transposes. Then this reduces to this, you expand this, transpose satisfies, see we have seen this operation of transpose earlier, this satisfies a reverse order law. So this is Z transpose, A transpose, B minus AX. This must hold for all Z, this must hold for all Z in Rn, which means you can again think of the inner product. The inner product of Z with this vector is 0 for all Z. See, this is again a kind of a transpose, Z transpose into some vector. See, this is a vector in Rn, okay. Please check, this is a vector in Rn. A transpose of something. See, A of something is in Rm, A transpose of something is in Rn. So this is a vector in Rn, okay. So compatibility, there is no problem. Z is in, so you look at this vector. This is a vector, I am sorry, this is a vector that is perpendicular to all vectors. So the vector must be 0. That is A transpose into B minus AX must be 0. That is if X is a best approximate solution. Okay, that is X is a best approximate solution if and only if X satisfies this equation. Okay, this intermediate variable U has been removed, that is Z has been removed. This is a necessary sufficient condition coming from the previous theorem for X to be a best approximate solution of the system AX equal to B. If AX is equal to B, if the system is consistent, this is obviously satisfied. Okay, but if it is not satisfied, then this condition must hold for that X, okay. If X, if AX minus B is not 0, then AX minus B must satisfy this. But what is this equation? You rewrite this as A transpose AX equals A transpose B. A transpose AX equal to A transpose B. Does this system have a solution? That is the problem. x is a best approximate solution if and only if x satisfies this equation. But is this system consistent? We need to consider that question also. Is this system consistent? Does this system have a solution? So given B, I can calculate the right hand side, I can calculate A transpose A. A is known. The question is this consistent? Is this system consistent? Okay. Do you have an answer? Can you rewrite, reformulate this question? See, what did I say with regard to this equation? Let's say the same question can be asked here. When is the system consistent? If B belongs to range of A. Okay. The question is, look at the vector A transpose B. Does it belong to range of A transpose A? Does the vector A transpose B belong to the range of A transpose A? That's the question. What is the answer? See, the answer is not really straightforward. So I don't expect you to give the answer. The answer is yes. Okay, the answer is yes, and look at the full picture. See, let me go back. The answer is yes. And look at the full picture. What is the full picture? Ax equal to b in general does not have a solution. There is no x that satisfies this equation. But there is always an x that satisfies this equation. Okay. So from an inconsistent system, we have come to a consistent system. You remember that we have gone from one system to another. We cannot go back. In general, we cannot go back. So there is no contradiction here. See, from this we have come to this, but you can't in general go back. And so these two systems are not the same. Okay, these two systems are not the same. If the systems are the same, then there is a contradiction. This is inconsistent, whereas this is consistent. Okay, just think it over. But I want to show this is consistent always. I want to show that this system is consistent irrespective of what B is. So the proof comes from this equation connecting subspace. That takes a little effort to prove. So I want to make the following claim. Look at range of A transpose. I want to show that this is equal to range of A transpose A. Range of A transpose is equal to range of A transpose A. We have not seen this equation before. One of the inclusions is straightforward. Range of A transpose A contained in range of A transpose. That's clear. It's the other way which requires a little effort. Suppose I prove this, okay? Then you can go back to this equation, see that this is consistent. Right hand side vector belongs to range of A transpose. The coefficient matrix here is A transpose A. So A transpose B belongs to range of A transpose A, and so this system is consistent. Okay. So we'll prove this. We'll prove this equation, and then it follows that that system is consistent, which means that there is always a best approximate solution for linear equations. Okay. Given an equation Ax equal to B, if it is consistent, there is no problem. If it is not consistent, we can always find a best approximate solution where the best approximation is with respect to the usual norm. That is, when I want to minimize norm Ax minus B, I am looking at the Euclidean norm. Okay? Okay, so I need to prove this. I told you that one of the inclusions is obvious. So let me record that. Obviously, range of A transpose A is contained in range of A transpose. By the way, you also need to verify that this equation makes sense. That is, we are talking about two subspaces in the same vector space. Is that first clear? See, okay, let's make a quick check of that. A transpose A is from Rn to Rn. A transpose A is a square matrix. If you look at A transpose, it's from Rm to Rn. A is from Rn to Rm. A transpose is from Rm to Rn. So if you look at range of A transpose A, that is here in Rn, range of A transpose is in Rn. So first of all, this equation is you can hope for the validity. It's well defined to talk about that. Okay, this is true. What I will show is that I must show that range of A transpose is contained range of A transpose A. Instead, I will show that the dimensions coincide. So I have two subspaces, one contained in the other, dimensions being the same, the subspaces must be the same. Okay. In order to prove that the dimension is the same, I will use rank nullity dimension theorem. But before that, I need the following. To prove this claim, I will prove another claim, which is null space of A transpose A equals, so can you make a guess of what this is? Range of A transpose A is equal to range of A transpose, it is null space of A, only then you will have compatibility. Again, you can check that this makes sense. A transpose A is null space of that is in Rn, A is from Rn to Rm, so null space of A is contained in Rn, both these are subspaces of Rn. This is easy to prove. Again, one of them is clear, which one? If Ax equal to 0, then A transpose Ax equal to 0. So null space of A is contained in null space of A transpose A. Okay, one inclusion is straightforward. That is, if Ax equal to 0, then A transpose Ax is 0. So if X belongs in null space of A, then X belongs in null space of A transpose A. I need to prove the other way around. So consider, let us take some vector different from X, say P. Suppose P belongs to null space of A transpose A, then A transpose AP is 0. This is the 0 vector. 0 vector is perpendicular to any vector, in particular to P. So P transpose into A transpose AP, this must be 0. P transpose into A transpose AP is 0. But this can be rewritten as AP transpose AP. But that is the same as saying inner product of AP with itself is 0. We are in Rn using the standard inner product, that is AP is 0. So we started with A transpose AP is 0, we have proved AP is 0. So it follows that P belongs to null space of A. So null space of A transpose A is equal to null space of A. Apply rank nullity dimension theorem and also apply the fact that the rank of a the row rank and the column rank are the same. Okay, so let us apply rank nullity dimension theorem for A transpose A first. Rank nullity dimension theorem for A transpose A. Rank of A transpose A plus I will write it in full, nullity A transpose A must be the dimension of the domain space, that is N. For A transpose, rank of A transpose, okay, rank of A plus nullity of A equals dimension of the domain space. I am applying it to A. Rank of A plus nullity of A is a dimension of the domain space. What I have shown is that null space of A and null space of A transpose A are the same. So I subtract one from the other. These two get cancelled. It means rank of A is equal to rank of A transpose A. You can't apply range immediately because range of A is in Rm. Okay. Range of A is in Rm. But rank of A is the same as rank of A transpose. So that is what you need to apply, then conclude. That is, rank of A is rank of A transpose. This is the same as saying that the row rank is the same as the column rank. So rank of A transpose is equal to rank of A transpose A. Now apply the fact that the dimension, what is the rank of A transpose A? It is the dimension of the range of A transpose A. Go back to this equation. So range of A transpose A, range of A transpose, they are the same, they are subspaces of the same vector space, their ranks coincide and one is contained in the other. So they must be equal. So range of A transpose is equal to range of A transpose A. Okay, so it is with this little extra effort using the rank nullity dimension theorem, one could show that the system A transpose AX equal to A transpose B is consistent. You might have come across this equation in numerical analysis. This is what is called as a normal equation. These equations are called normal equations in the problem of for instance interpolation. Okay, so in the normal equations are always consistent. So that is the complete answer then. This gives a method in principle if you want a best approximate solution of this equation. By the way, we have to go back to the familiar least square solution, okay, because our norms are the Euclidean norms, sums of squares or integrals of squares. So it is a least square solution. If the system Ax equal to b is inconsistent, then one seeks least square solutions. Least square solutions always exist. Least square solutions always exist. That is the same as saying the system is consistent. Okay. Least square solutions always exist. The question is whether the least square solutions are unique. Let me just give you an instance where the least square solution is unique and stop. So I have the following result. Suppose that the columns of A are linearly independent. Then the least squares solution of the system Ax equal to b is unique. I will give two proofs. One uses a principle, the other one will be useful in practice. Proof 1. I am looking at the equation A transpose AX equals A transpose B. When the columns of A are linearly independent, what is the null space of A? When the columns of A are linearly independent, what is the null space of A? Singleton 0. Null space of A we have shown to be equal to something else, some other subspace. What is that? Just now we proved null space of A transpose A. The difference between A and A transpose A is if even if A is rectangle, whatever be A transpose A is square. Whatever be A transpose A is square. A transpose A is a square matrix whose null space consists of singleton 0. So A transpose A as a linear transformation is injective, but since it is square it must be surjective, so it must be invertible. So A transpose A inverse exists, just pre multiply by A transpose A inverse to get X to be A transpose A inverse A transpose B. This is unique. because this is like this is a system where the coefficient matrix is invertible. So the system must have a unique solution. Okay, that unique solution is given by this formula. We will come back and look at this formula, A transpose A inverse A transpose. We will discuss the notion of generalized inverse in place of this. Okay, that will be done a little later. This is a proof which uses the principle that null space of A transpose A equal to null space of A. In practice, one could use the QR decomposition. So my second proof is by using the QR decomposition. Okay, before I give the second proof, let this be clear. Ax equal to b, if it is consistent, the question of finding a least square solution doesn't arise. So this question arises only if Ax equal to b is inconsistent. If Ax equal to b is inconsistent and if the columns are independent, there is a unique least square solution. If not, there are infinitely many least square solutions. In general, there are infinitely many least square solutions. In such a case, which solution would you be satisfied with? Infinitely many least square solutions, you should be satisfied with the one solution which, for which a suggestion is to look at a vector which has the least norm among all those vectors. Okay. This problem we will discuss later. For instance, if you have a, even in the case of a rectangular system of consistent equations, there are infinitely many solutions. Rectangular system, consistent, infinitely many solutions. You should be satisfied with the one with the least norm. The same rule applies for the inconsistent case also. Ax equal to b inconsistent, but it has least square solution. In general, there are infinitely many least square solution. There is a situation when the solution is unique. So if you go back to the problem when there are infinitely many least square solutions, you should be interested in the minimum norm, least norm of all those solutions. The question of whether such a vector exists, we will discuss that later. Okay, just to give a little more enlarged picture, I wanted to make this comment. So I will just go back to the second proof and tell you how the QR decomposition could be used. Second proof, I have Ax equal to b, and this from this I get A transpose Ax equals A transpose b. Okay, that's the equation corresponding to the normal equations. A is QR. This is applicable because the columns of A are independent. Okay, remember the framework in which we derived the QR decomposition. The columns of A must be linearly independent. That's the situation here. So this is possible. A equal to QR with Q transpose Q being identity of order n. R is invertible. R is invertible and upper triangular. So go back and substitute here. A transpose A is okay. I'll write down this quickly. R transpose Q transpose Q R, that is the left hand side, equals R transpose Q transpose B. Q transpose Q is identity. R transpose R X equals R transpose Q transpose B. R is square invertible. So R is square invertible. R transpose is also invertible. So this is the same as Rx equals Q transpose B. From this one can write X is equal to R inverse Q transpose B. Okay. Of course that is possible. But then one would like to stop with this and then look at the structure of R and see what you must do to solve the system. R is upper triangular. R is upper triangular. So the last equation has only one variable. The last but one equation has two variables, etc. So we do what is called as a backward substitution. Find the variable xn from the last equation, go to the previous one, find xn minus 1, etc. The first equation gives x1. Okay. So this is solved by backward substitution. Okay, so this is something that could be applied in a numerical example, whereas this gives a conceptual proof. Okay, so let me stop.